Ho Jeff community, welcome back to First Frequency of One is Shock Metaphysics. I am your host, Reverend Dr. Philippe Shock Matthews, and known as the Metaphysical Morpheus. And guess what? It's Thursday, which means there's a crazy man in the video. And that's him right over there. It's a crazy man in the video that we love and absolutely adore. And his name is Dr. Clyde Winters. What's going on, Baba? How you feeling today?
I'm feeling okay. I'm you know, it's raining out here in Chicago area. It's raining, so I can't get that melanin boost. I can't get that melanin boost. My energy level is kind of a little low. I'm trying to pick it up since I'm here with the family, and I'm going to try to overcome that. Hard, you know.
Do you suffer from SAD, seasonal affective disorder, where like when it's rainy and for a long period of time, does your mood shift a little bit?
No, not really.
I noticed that that's one of the things, like one reason why I don't visit San Francisco as often is because I just notice when I'm around doom and gloom, gloomy weather, it just, and we've had that for a while in Sacramento. And I've just been like, oh, when is the sun coming out? So it's sunny and bright today after all of that rain and all of that monsoon that was coming down. So that, and getting that melanin spike, that's just the most beautiful thing. It's so necessary for us.
Yeah, you know, you got to get that melanin photosynthesis, you know, because even though nobody really wants to acknowledge it, especially, second frequency, the sun does have a tremendous effect on us in terms of our health and in terms of our attitudes. And that's one of the reasons why we like to be in sunny areas, you know.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, it's interesting we're talking about this because in the green room, we were talking about just intelligence and the difference between IQ and EQ, intellectual intelligence and emotional intelligence or emotional quotient, EQ. And I remember I did an interview with Dr. Luann Bresendine, who's a neuroscientist and brain expert, actually out here in San Francisco. And she called me an autodidact based upon my ability to just pick up things and learn them and move forward without having, at that time, I didn't have any traditional education. I had no letters behind my name or in front of my name. So she labeled me an autodidact. And you kind of went off on that a little bit. I thought it was a compliment. You're like, no, that's not a compliment. Why do you say that?
Well, it's not a compliment because when somebody calls you an autodidact, they're saying in a sense that you don't have any intelligence and that there's such a thing as native intelligence. Okay, first of all, people don't understand that an IQ or intelligence quotient is based upon the experiences that you have. Mm-hmm. That makes sense. Usually, when we determine IQ, we give somebody an academic test. And this academic test, it usually in a sense, tests, you know, what is your math knowledge? What is your reading knowledge? What is your verbal knowledge? You know, how do you understand words and things like that? Mm-hmm. So naturally, the majority of us have an inappropriate education so that we're going to be judged if we go off the traditional IQ or intelligence quotient. We're going to be judged as being the other or insignificant or not as worthy as maybe.
Not as good as. Mm-hmm.
Yes, not as good as. But see, really, in a sense, an intelligence quotient is based upon what you've learned and what you know. Mm-hmm. Therefore, what happens is that at the turn of the 20th century, people in France, they wanted to find a way to make sure that they could ensure that the children of the middle class would always have job opportunities. And because they wanted to make sure in the sense that the children of the middle class was always held higher and separate from the children from the common folk, they developed in a sense these tests. And these tests, in a sense, was based upon knowledge that children learn from their tutors. Okay, you had a public school. For example, in England, what they call public school is really private school. In other words, the elites sent their kids to certain schools. The same thing in France. You either had private schools or you had tutoring. And since the tutors taught you math, reading, then therefore, in a sense, the intelligence test or the IQ test was based upon how well you read, how well you understood mathematics, and how well, in a sense, you could create formulas. And but what this did is that because of the fact that only the middle class kids attended school, then that meant that all the top jobs in government and industry would be in a sense taken by in a sense, you know, those people who had had an education, which was a middle class. But they still wanted you to have a basic knowledge. That's why they had a public education. They still want you to know the rudiments of reading, writing, stuff like that. For example, my parents, they only went to the fourth grade, you know, when they were down in Mississippi before they came. Mm-hmm. And the most amazing thing that always struck me as so peculiar until I got into brain-based learning was the fact that many of my students, and I taught high school, I taught all the way from elementary school up to high school, but basically I was in junior high and high school. And I found interesting that many of my high school students couldn't read as good as my father.
Wow.
A fourth grade education. And so then that struck me as kind of peculiar. But then the longer I taught, I began to see, in a sense, that Black kids in the South back in the day were taught by Black teachers. Mm-hmm. And these Black teachers, they understood how Black children learn, which in a sense, a lot of our learning is kinetic. What I mean by kinetic is that a lot of it is from feelings and touching and being able, in a sense, to have feelings, you see.
Mm-hmm.
But you've been taught that feelings are related to emotion. Since feelings are related to emotion, they say that Black people are too emotional and that's why we can't learn shit. No, that's not right. It's totally improbable because you got to remember, you know, knowledge is relative. We always come back to those, what do you call the Akashic records or whatever that
is? The Akashic records, yeah. The
Akashic records, you tell me every weekend, and I always name it. Oh, what's wrong with me?
Brain-based learning. You have to know.
But we have the Akashic records. And what you find is that many people marveled at the fact that after slavery, many Black people who never went to school taught themselves to read.
So
you said, how could people learn how to read? How could people have all this knowledge? Well, then we come down to this whole idea of genetic memory. And I don't know if I made the phrase up or I got it from somebody else, but I think I made it up, but I can't remember how long I've been using it. But the point is that there's the Akashic records are out there because of the fact that we invented the alphabet, because of the fact that we invented knowledge, period, then therefore we have access to this ability. We can draw on those tablets. And see,
oh, sure. Yes.
She was telling you that you were autodidactic. She was trying to imply in the sense that you were somewhat an inferior. It's not that you were an inferior, you are a superior. And the reason that you're superior is because of the fact that as a first frequency person, you're able to draw off of those records that exist if you so desire.
Mm-hmm. And I did. And I do. Yeah.
You have to desire it. You have to desire it. And see, the more you desire it, and the more you can get in contact with these with this higher authority. For example, last week we talked about Amma.
Mm-hmm.
When we talked about Amma, you brought up the very important fact is that you have to, in a sense, sometimes to access information, you have to have those words, you know, that can be keywords that can help you to access that information. That's why the Bible tells you that in the beginning there was a word and the word was with God. Same thing in the Quran. And so what does this mean? This means in a sense that words are more important than anything. When I was growing up, you know, when women were real and they weren't infected with this white feminism, to really be able to talk to a woman, you had to be able, in a sense, to be a words craftsman. You had to be able to sense the words, and they were going to test you on what is your vocabulary. Today we have so many weak men that we have a group of people called the passport bros. And what the passport bros do is that they go to El Salvador, Brazil, and you know, I heard about this years ago because my daughter, I told her she's a police officer, and some of her colleagues back in the 90s, they would 90s, early 2000s, what they would do is that they would go down to Brazil or Santo Domingo, and then go rent a prostitute and have a prostitute cook for them for a week, and maybe, you know, provide them with sex and all that type of stuff for a week, get them real cheap. And so now they label themselves the passport bros. No, you're just going to look for a whore. These women, because of the fact that these women don't have any money, you're able to go down there and spend a couple hundred dollars on them with sex, cooking, etc. But you're dealing, you're nothing but a pseudo European, because you're doing exactly what the European does. You're exploiting these women, and you're trying to say that these women are better than foundational Black American women. You're full of shit, man.
Absolutely, because you're afraid of real true Black women.
Because you have no game.
You have no game. That's an absolute fact. That's a fact.
Because you have no game, then therefore, in a sense, you don't know how to talk to your women. And I mean, it's easy to go and pay some woman, a prostitute, to provide you with oral sex. White women grow up on oral sex. As they grow up on oral sex, I mean, it seems as though they're born oral sexers.
Absolutely, exactly. And
because they're born oral sexers, and that's what your culture represents. Because today, a lot of people are into that rap culture. That's all the rappers talk about.
That's all they're talking about.
The thing is, this is that the European is smart as hell. Let me explain to you. The European is smart as hell because he knows that if you become solely involved in oral sex, then therefore that's an individualistic phenomenon. You gain satisfaction. Your so-called partner might gain satisfaction, but there's no exchange. There's no exchange of information, so you never grow as an individual. That's what that lady, when she was telling you were autodidactic, she was telling you that you were that because she didn't understand that you grow every day. See, the more you, in a sense, interviewed all these famous people, the more you interviewed these people, then therefore you were able to ask them questions that most of us can never ask them questions because we didn't have access to them. Because you were able to ask them questions, you were able to get better answers, more sufficient answers about what it was that they were teaching. And as you were getting better answers about what it was that they were teaching, you was able, in a sense, to add that information to your information that was already stored in your memory. And so then that made you become a more rounded person. And see, that's the problem with second frequency. Second frequency, because of their lack of melanin, they can't go through that whole idea of melanophotosynthesis. Because they don't have that melanophotosynthesis. That means, in a sense, that their source of information is not the Akashic records. Their source of information is a book. So that's why every time there's a cataclysm, their civilizations fall, you see, and they completely fall. And then they talk about dark ages because they can't have access to that book that provides them with their memory. See, the book provides them with the memory. There's nothing wrong with books. We've always been a very literate people, as I've tried to tell you over the years. And because we're literate people, we've always been involved with writing and stuff like that. But because of the fact that second frequency lacks that melanophotosynthesis, their whole library, their whole knowledge, in a sense, is contained in a book. Whereas, I remember back in the day, when I used to teach educational psychology to my students, I always tell them, I said that, we don't know where the mind is. I said, in space, it could be in the foot. I said, but you got to remember is that whenever I give you a test, that test doesn't show me what you've learned in my class. Remember that. Mm-hmm. That test doesn't show me what you've learned in my class. That test only shows me when I give you a test related to what I'm teaching you in relation to educational psychology. That test only shows me what you're able to regurgitate to me through a test. I said, the only way I can really tell how smart you was is to take a scalpel, open up your brain, and see if the synapses grew.
No, don't do that.
Grew. But they would call me a bad professor, and I'm sorry.
Yes, they would. You wouldn't be here right now with us. I know that. That would not have worked out.
I'd be in a Pontiac prison.
Yes.
But I could tell those people they were smart or not.
They were smart. I saw it with my own eyes when I cut their brains open. So this is fascinating to me because throughout our relationship and your scholarship on this platform, you have shown us some of our scholars who didn't have a quote unquote traditional education. But now I understand they had a very high IQ, and I always get it wrong. Is it John Jackson or what? Who was it that was the janitor or that didn't go that had a fourth grade education, didn't go to school, but wrote an amazing piece of work? Who was that person in our culture?
Well, I don't know about a fourth grade education, but I used to.
It might not be a fourth grade. I'm thinking probably about my parents that had a fourth grade education and yours.
Like Hunter Adams, he did a lot of work.
That's it.
He did a lot of work on the Dogon, but he wouldn't get his degree. And he used to work at Argonne National Laboratory. And I told him, you know, over the years, I said, Hunter, get your degree because, you know, you might get in trouble down the road. Oh, fuck you, Clyde. Well, he didn't say that out loud, but then later in a sense, he was going around pretending that he was a physicist.
Uh-oh.
No, that's high science for white folks.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Feel that being in a sense and a physicist is the highest science you can get. And so then they found out that he was the janitor, the custodian at Argonne National Laboratory.
Wow.
Physicists. And they used
wow.
See, they used Hunter Adams and Ivan Van Sertima to prove in a sense that black people didn't know what that Afrocentrists really didn't know anything about about black history and stuff. But see, they didn't understand that Hunter, he knew a lot, but because he didn't have he never became the scarecrow, you know. He never became the scarecrow. Mm-hmm. Of the mm-hmm. Wizard of Oz. And because he never became the scarecrow of the Wizard of Oz, and what is a scarecrow? The Wizard of Oz makes it obvious to you that to really in this society show that you have a brain or you're intelligent, you have to have a degree. You
see? Mm-hmm.
And
mm-hmm.
that degree is just a piece of paper. You see?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so then, what we find is that people like John, I mean George Jackson, John, I mean John Jackson, J.A. Rogers, Richard Wright, these people, in a sense, they were grassroots scholars or grassroots mm-hmm. Authors. And, you know, all this week, you know, ever since Monday, I've been thinking a lot about Zora Neale Hurston.
Mm-hmm.
Think about Nora Zora Neale.
Aren't they running a special on her or something on PBS or something?
Yeah, they had a special on PBS about her. But they've got about six or seven, you know, because one of the guys in the class, I forgot his name, he had asked me because we were going through various fields of the social sciences. And
yes.
He said, Dr. Winters, why should we be interested in folklore? You know.
Yes, yes, yes. No, I think that was Silver Moneybag, I believe. That was, I believe that's who it was. I'm not sure. I think it was a female. I'm not sure. But y'all, whoever's in the audience, if y'all know it, if you're in the class, let us know.
It may was that. I think it was Cool Dude or somebody.
Oh, Ralph. Okay.
You know, Ralph. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Because he.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah.
Because he had brought the fact that he was reading my book.
Nope. She said it. That was her. Silver Moneybag. Yeah. And I always forget your actual real name, Goddess. I'm going to get it, though. By the 15th week.
No. So And so, but what it was is that, what it was is that, see, when you look at our intelligentsia, you know, W.E.B. Du Bois, he said that the majority of our intelligentsia, because they were boule, they couldn't be counted on to really illuminate our history. And many of them suffered from CAIDS. Even though you may think of them as super deluxe people, like Greg on Karen Hunter's program, and Greg Carr, they have a beautiful program, but they're boule in the sense that they talk some nice stuff about Afrocentrism, Africology, but again, they always go back to those people who had the economic background to go to Morehouse, to go to Spelman, you know, to go to these various colleges. For example, one of my idols has always been Paul Robeson, and I Paul Robeson because he did two things that I do. He played football and he was a great linguist.
Mm-hmm.
But Paul Robeson, in his background, he has a lot of ministers.
He had a lot of
professional black people. So then therefore they had money when they came mm-hmm. into when he decided to go to university and all that type of stuff. And then many other people that Greg Carr talks about and Karen Hunter talk about, they're usually talking about boule people. And mm-hmm. there's nothing wrong with the boule class, but we've learned more from those grassroots historians.
Yes.
Like Zora Neale Hurston. Yeah, Zora Neale Hurston. Yeah, her dad was a preacher. But you know, after her mother died, you know, he kicked in a sense, Zora Neale Hurston, he kicked her out the house at 13.
Wow.
Into the school and paid the first quarter dues and then said fuck you bitch, and then
wow.
13-year-old daughter,
wow,
without any type of way to stay in school. But she's a smart young lady. She what she did, she started cleaning houses, cleaning clothes, and became a manicurist.
Wow.
But she always had a desire to go to school. And so mm-hmm. what Neale Hurston did is that, what she did is that she when she got to Baltimore, she was 26 years old.
Wow.
And although she was 26 years old, she saw that she could go to night school. You know, that was back in the day, up until the 1870s, you could go to night school and all that was free. And so mm-hmm. she decided she was going to go back to school. And so what she did is that, she pretended she was 16. She wasn't 16, she was 26. But she pretended she was 16. She was able, in a sense, to go to one of the schools there that had an program. She got her high school diploma. Then she went on to Howard University, and she got her associate degree. Then she went to Barnard University, you know, a white university, and she got her BA degree. And so then this sent her on a path to be one of the greatest anthropologists. But see, she,
wow.
this woman wrote tens of articles. She mm-hmm. wrote about five or six books. She died as a maid in Florida.
Mm.
You may ask, how? How in the world could a scholar of that dynamic in a sense, how could she end up dying as a maid, but really dying in a house? She had a couple of strokes, and then they put her into a welfare home, and she died there. But mm-hmm. it's just like you say that a scholar like that, she should have been teaching at a university.
Mm-hmm, absolutely.
All these so-called black, these BCUs, black colleges and universities, you know, all that bullshit. It was plenty of them, but they didn't hire this woman. She was a skilled anthropologist. She didn't have to watch the movie. She worked with Boas. And yet they didn't give her a good-ass job. Why?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I'll tell you why. She was a grassroots scholar. In wow. other words, she had one problem. She had one damn fault. She had one fault, and her fault was she loved her people.
That ain't a fault.
Oh, yes, that's a fault, man. I mean, come on, man, you know.
I know, I know. Huh?
Kick the nigga's ass. That's what they do. Kick the nigga down. And so,
right.
This woman.
Especially, and this is during Jim Crow, so you know this was, it was nearly, near impossible. But we do have more opportunities today, but still, there's a self-esteem, you know, a lot of our people, and even some of the people that's been in our class, or not my, our class, but your class, your Afrocentric class, even Amra, she didn't feel that she could be smart and do this, and she did it, and you kept your promise, and she stayed with it, and she produced an amazing piece of work.
Yeah, see,
and most of us don't believe in ourselves enough to that we can do this.
She believed in herself, and she had the qualifications, but Du Bois talked about this fact is that the bougie class, the boule class, mm-hmm. they suffered from caves.
They were third frequency in a very real sense, right?
That's right, because see, they feel in the sense that they feel that they're better than you, and they know they're mm-hmm. better than you because of the fact that their parents had the money and you didn't have shit. And
mm-hmm. see, you know,
the fact that even though Zora Neale Hurston's father was a minister, he kicked her out at 13 years old. Think about this. Here's a woman
wow.
at 13 years old, a girl, and she still tried to stay decent. And she still tried mm-hmm. to do those things that could help her to be recognized as a respectful woman.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
She wrote all those fine books. See, but here's the whole problem is that a lot of Black people feel no matter how much education you get, you're dumb. You're just as they feel that any Black person is just as smart as the other Black person. So you
right.
have no right. You have no right to believe right. that you should be recognized as somebody that's important.
And so mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
given all those Black colleges back there, given her background, they should have had her at one of those Black colleges teaching anthropology.
Absolutely.
You know what she would have did?
What did she do?
She would have trained too many Black men and women who would have had the confidence
mm-hmm.
to really feel they could go out and do research. See, that's mm-hmm. the problem with a grassroots historian, a grassroots person. Who would I consider grassroots scholars? I consider a number one, Jay Rogers.
Mm-hmm.
He came to Chicago and he wanted to go to the Art Institute. He wanted to go into art history. And yet this man wrote so many great books about Black history, about Black people everywhere in the world. He even mm-hmm. went around the world. He was kind of, in a sense, doing his own studies. He used
yes.
his own money, but he had to have a job first. And by
mm-hmm.
being a Pullman porter, he made the money so he could be able to take those options. See, remember, every week when I talk about the fact that I celebrate, in a sense, my Patreon, I celebrate my Patreon and the people in my Patreon, because they're giving me the money that I can go to these libraries. I can pay
absolutely.
These. I order about 7-8 new books every week because
that's
I need
right.
books.
That's about right. That's about right.
In my
yes. It, absolutely.
If I gave you in a sense the presentation on Monday, that presentation is changed by Friday because
mm-hmm.
I've ordered the books from that last week. When the books come in by that Saturday, I had to read those books over and make sure that I have the latest knowledge. I give you guys out there, family. I give you the latest knowledge.
Absolutely,
the latest
that's a fact.
And
that's
why
a fact.
That PDF, even though a lot of people don't buy them, they don't even understand. You're not going to see that. That's that issue.
Doesn't exist anywhere. Exactly. Exactly.
Road,
speaking of which, let me put that in the chat. Yes.
And see, that's the thing with you know, with Zora Neale Hurston, is that she was writing real stuff, 5 books.
Yeah. And you know how hard it was publishing a book back then?
Yeah. And you know, white people controlled that totally.
Completely.
Totally. And that even though she was around, even though she was around in a sense, a lot of black men, no, most of those black men in a sense, they were kiss asses to this white rich lady. And they, you know, they wouldn't dare do anything that was to illuminate. See, a lot of people, they talk that blackish. What did I say? Black.
He's trying to get it out. Yes.
They talk it.
They do.
They don't really do research.
And no, see, they don't.
That's why you got, and then you had Jay Rogers, George Jackson. You had, and then Carter G. Woodson. Okay, yeah, he was professionally trained, but he still learned how he began reading to the people that was on his job, and he was telling them before he even went to college. He was telling them different facts. And see, a lot of these brothers, they couldn't understand during the Harlem Renaissance. They couldn't understand a woman that had pride in herself. And a woman that wanted to be a scholar, because mm-hmm. they were scholars.
Mm-hmm. They were
scholars. Look at all those people in the Harlem Renaissance. They didn't write as many books as she wrote. They didn't do research articles.
That's true.
She was a real scholar of her time, but nobody recognized her because of the fact that the Boulé felt my daddy, mama had money, my auntie, cousin, mm-hmm. and shit. So I didn't respect you.
Wow.
Just about every black person. Feel they know every other black person, but there's only one shortcoming, you see, in the sense that I'm so happy though that I fell in love with my wife before I really started doing this research. Because see, when you start really researching your people and the beauty of our history and the stories of our history, they can make you become obsessed mm-hmm. with doing that research, and often it can make your mate feel very jealous. Like my wife, mm-hmm. was never jealous of any woman. You know, she was beautiful anyway. And I mean, I had a very elegant wife, and she was elegant. She was a lady, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. so I wanted, and because she was a true first frequency woman, she carried herself in a very elegant fashion.
Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm.
when it came to my research, you better keep that shit out of my room. You better not take it to my living room.
Right.
Over there in the corner.
Right. Number
two. Don't you do no research while I'm woke. You just look at my beautiful ass.
And you had no problem doing that at all.
I had but what happened is that I'd have to wait till the middle of the night.
Right. To get up and sneak and do the research. That's hilarious.
I had to wait till she was
sleeping. I love it. I love it.
She woke up, she's gonna say, Claude, get your ass up here. Get in this bed, nigga.
I love that.
But that was a problem though with Zora Neale Hurston, is that she never could really have a good marriage, because the fact that this is that I think she was just always too careful into that research, and that would make her man feel negligent. But see, yes. I learned early that my wife, my baby doll, was the most important thing on the planet. Back in the day, I used to hang around with all the black power people. I used to hang around with the so-called the Arabs. I'm talking about the Arab Muslims.
Mm-hmm. The real ones. Yeah. Not that the other ones aren't real. I didn't mean it that way. But I know what you mean. I
used to hang around with Suleiman Yang. He used to be the head of the African Studies Department at Howard.
Sure.
You know, so I was with these people, but my wife, you know, two things happened. Number one, Asa Hilliard. He wanted Hunter and Ivan Van Sertima to let me help them write the Portland essays. They mm-hmm. said, Clyde, he don't get no outside sex. Mm-hmm. He don't want to play around. So then Clyde, we can't have him with us because he's not gonna be on
He's too clean. He's too clean.
So therefore, in a sense, they cut me out, so we stopped being friends. Also, Ivan Van Sertima said that a white dude at Harvard told him that he couldn't be my friend anymore, so he wanted the whitey first. So I mean, that was his second frequency.
Right. Then,
the same year, they were having a conference down in Urbana, University of Illinois Champaign Urbana. So Suleiman Yang, he called me and he said, "Clyde, you coming down to the meeting?" I said, "I can't come down to the I can't come down to this presentation because I never paid any fucking money to ride the airplane. They paid the fucking money. I didn't pay it." So anyway, they were having a conference down at the University of Illinois, and they said, "You gotta come down." I said, "My wife is sick, and I can't come down." And so then that night, I had a dream about Suleiman Yang, And so Sulaiman Nang, he let me look at his Quran. When I opened up his Quran, it was full enough of women, you know.
Oh wow.
It was nothing in their Arabic, it was all women. And anybody that knows Sulaiman Nang know he had about 3 or 4 wives or whatever before he died, but that doesn't matter. But then after my Black Power brothers put me down, after my Muslim brothers put me down, then I said, damn, but my wife is always here. And I made a promise to myself that I would never put anything in front of my wife ever. Mm-hmm. Because I knew that she was my friend.
And absolutely. My
friend. She was my lover. She was everything to me. And so mm-hmm. in that sense, and so that's why I'm telling anybody. It's try not to let your search for knowledge, let your search for engagement with understanding who you are. Don't let that dominate your life, because see, it's the people in your life that matter.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
People in your life that matter. And so Zora Neale Hurston, she did a lot of beautiful research. She did a wealth of research that makes us understand ourselves. See, we don't understand. A lot of Black people back then, They wanted to try to, in a sense, explain to white people how Black people were, but in their explanation, they felt that they were inferior. See,
mm-hmm.
Zora Neale Hurston was always against. She was always against integration. She didn't like the 1954 decision that opened up the schools, because she felt that if Black people are forced into integration, they were going to lose much of their society, much of their mm-hmm. culture, much of their history, mm-hmm. and she was right.
Absolutely.
I know, because my auntie taught me. But most Black people, they don't know about the simple lives that we had. They don't know about mm-hmm. the languages that we spoke mm-hmm. as Black people before our integration. They don't know our folk tales. They don't know our life stories. You see,
mm-hmm.
so she mm-hmm. was right. We lost a lot of economic wealth when people mm-hmm. began totally integrating. So was before her time, but at the same time, in a sense, she was a victim. She was a victim due to her love for her people. She mm-hmm. was a victim due to her love for being Black. And see, that's why, even though a lot of people like, you know, like Carr, Greg Carr at Howard and Karen Hunter, they talk a lot of Black shit, and it sounds real cool, but mm-hmm. they're really boule.
Mm-hmm.
They're really,
mm-hmm.
they really in a sense are trying to explain something. You know, for example, the organization that Greg Carr works for, they've been supposed to write a ancient history of Black people for over 50 years.
Mm.
And that's still, he's still on the committee. And look at the students who've taken my class. Amra,
right,
B-Man, right. You know, right. Aisha, you know, these people, Sister Shanice, they're writing articles, they're writing books, you know, Paquette. And they're writing articles and books.
Absolutely. And yeah, that's people, let's just ponder that for a moment. Yeah, let's ponder that for a moment. It's like, talk about changing the direction of your life, becoming someone that you've never been. You go through this class, you go through this course, and you come out with a superpower to be able to produce high intellectual work and scholarship and produce it in multiple forms. And it's kind of scary. I ain't gonna lie. It's kind of scary.
It is scary.
Because some people, white and Black, have paid hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars to get a certain level of information, and still they don't have books and published papers. So go ahead.
They got that piece of paper called a degree.
Right. They got a piece of paper called a degree, but
they have nothing to show for it. That's why I wanted to try to get this book done by Feb. It's just not going to happen. I'm gonna have it done this year, but I'm not gonna stress myself over it. I've lost enough hair, so but it's coming, fam. So yeah, I just think that, you know, I'm looking at in the last couple of weeks, we just started our class, your class. I keep saying it's our class, it's your class. But I keep looking at the folks that are just 30, I think it's 31 or something like that, people, students, and I'm listening to what they want to produce. And I'm so excited because I know, because I'm a publisher, I'm the marketer. And I'm just waiting for the work to get done, get through this 15 weeks and get their first paper, because I know exactly what to take them. And so that they, it's almost like a leapfrog, but really what it is called, it's called a quantum leap. Because it's a quantum leap, because one minute you were here for X amount of years, now you're way over here. And all of the people in between are looking and saying, well, how did Silver Moneybag go from here to here? How did Joan go from here to here? How, because they're looking at you, but you're shifting and changing because you're vibrating so fast. Your frequency is going up. That means you're vibrating a lot faster. You're able to assimilate and process knowledge because germane or built into the class, you incorporate brain-based learning. And so, I just love the effect of this. Of my mama was basic. She just called it going from shit to sugar. Basically, it's what she called it. Baby, you're just gonna have to go from shit to sugar. That's what you're gonna do. I was like, okay, mama, that's what I'll do. But that's what the group is able to do and create a level of self-esteem and self-efficacy that they did not have before.
And you know, and so ever since Silver Money brought that up, that's what I've been thinking about all week, is that that's what we're developing. We're developing grassroots historians, psychologists, demographers. You know, we're developing people in a sense who have a high self-esteem and they're B1.
Right. It's never been done before in history. It's never been done before.
This
is so exciting.
We had our Zora Neale Hurstons, we had our George Jacksons, we had our Jay Rogers, but they weren't being produced. You know, look at how many people got PhDs in agroecology from Temple University and then wrote shit.
Right.
Look at these black archaeologists. They're excavating, you know, slave plantations. Nigga, what? We know what they did.
Right.
We know what they did. What you gonna? Oh yeah, I found a pig bone. That showed that during slavery, black people ate the hog.
Come on.
I also found in a sense a chicken foot bone. That shows that black people during slavery, they ate chicken bone.
You're so wrong. Right.
Dumbass.
Right. Right. Right.
Thank you. All praise along to God. And thank you for telling Reverend Matthews to tell me to teach this class, because we're developing
first black intelligentsia.
Grassroots scholars.
Absolutely.
Who have high self-esteem. Scholars who believe in themselves. And scholars who are going to set that damn world on fire. I don't give a damn. Burn this motherfucker.
Burn, baby, burn. Disco Inferno. That's my jam.
Presentation.
That's my jam, fam. Yeah, we could go on and on. You know how we do.
Yeah, but Zora Neale Hurston, and all of you guys should look at our story. Look at our story. That's a beautiful one. But the point is that everything does not come from black men. Yeah, you want to look at that leadership. You may.
Mm-hmm.
We need the sisters out there. To
like absolutely.
Ow!
There he goes. Ow. Okay. Oh, there's his medication kicking in. What? So today I also know you did a PDF on this. Sumerians in South America.
Yeah.
So.
So talk to us about the PDF that comes along with that. As you're getting this thing up, as you're getting your PowerPoint booted up.
For some reason, they're not showing my tabs.
Uh-oh.
Can you see that?
No, it's not in there yet. You haven't shared your screen yet.
Oh.
Hey, there's Ron Spears. Let me send a shout out to everybody. Ron Spears was with us yesterday. Absolute amazing cipher. Joan, I see you out there. Zachary Holmes, Akil. Welcome back. Silver Money Bag. Love you, Goddess. Pharaoh Tut, my dude. PJ, Pamela, welcome back, Goddess. Rose Mitchell. Reba Henderson is back in the house with us. And I got both Melvins. I got Melvin Reed and Melvin Wright. So I'm excited to see you guys with us again. And All the Way Free is here with us as well. This is just absolutely wonderful. Kefir Ka, Harud, Judimus is with us. CB is with us. Everybody is back here with us. Y'all ain't got nothing to do on a Thursday afternoon. March is with us. Uh-oh, you got to go to the other computer?
They won't let me share.
Oh, no. That's a new computer. Darlene X, I see you out there, Curly Girl. What's going on, fam? You know all of this technology and all this stuff that you're doing. They don't like you no more, Clyde.
I know. I've been...
this time. They don't like you. They don't want you to figure out nothing. not the ing, just nothing.
I go to present.
Hey, Cheryl Lynn, what's going on? I haven't seen you in a minute. Good to see you, Goddess. That's another genius in the research class. Cheryl Lynn with Afrocentric fashion and fabrics. I can't wait for that to get published. Can't wait to see that paper. That's going to be amazing. Facebook user says, good to see you, Philippe. I don't know who Facebook user is. It's a Facebook user, though. So that's what's coming up. Wow, you're having some technical difficulties. Are you not?
Yes, I am.
Yes, you are. I thought you did it once before, but you didn't.
Can you see it now?
Nope. You haven't shared it.
Damn.
Cheryl said, I've been here. Okay, Cheryl, I'm sorry if I missed you. But I'm seeing you now. So how you doing, Goddess? Oh, poor Dr. Clyde Winters, he's having technical difficulties. God forbid we got to get on that other computer. We know that's a piece of you know what. But Got to sit in the internet, not near the internet. You got to sit in the damn internet, in the router, to get that other one working.
You know, it's a totally different screen than I ever saw before.
Oh, okay. There's a different interface too. You went from what, Windows what to what?
11.
Oh, 10 to 11. So I don't know what the interface looks like, but sometimes they make some radical changes to move stuff around. All right. Nothing's happening here. You're going to have to just talk about it. It'll be your first lecture where you just talked about it, which will be fine. Hell, that would be great. Are you kidding me? Okay, now something's coming up, Doc.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is. Look at the screen. I see your PowerPoint right now.
Oh.
There it is. You did it.
Now I can't get off this other screen. I don't know, man. These people are messing with me.
Oh, that's hilarious.
Started. Can you see it?
Now, if you want, I can. It is actually giving me access to move your slides, so I can advance your slides if you like.
No, that's okay. I'll try this.
Okay. Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, the Sumerians in South America, Kukaki, that's the name of that the Sumerians called, probably called the Tin Land or the land in the West. And here we are in the middle. We can see some pictures of some of the Sumerians, and I deciphered their names, all that type of good stuff. But and then also on the right hand side, you see a book I wrote on the Sumerian language. Yes. South America, they teach you that South America didn't have writing. They did have writing. And this writing was what we did. Please join my Patreon. As I said before, my Patreon guys, thank you so much for your support. You're helping me to be able to make these slides every week. And so I shouldn't really just say that by Dr. Clyde Winters. They're by my entire Patreon, because you guys, in a sense, are providing me with the support that allows me to go out and do this type of research. The slides are going to be found on my Patreon. Okay, you can. I'd like you to go to YouTube and.
Hold on, Doc. You're not advancing any slides. Nothing's moving. You're still
something on your end.
All we see. All I see right now is the same opening slide. I can move them, so I could just go to your pen. So I just did it on my end. Right. So
what's why are they doing that?
I don't think that's them. I think that's just something with your UI, your user interface that is slightly different. So I've got your Patreon up here, your Patreon page. What was the next? Just tell me to advance the slides as you go through it. And then I can just move it for the community if you're not able to do it on your own. Which is weird. I don't know why.
Okay.
So your next slide was your channel content on your YouTube.
Yeah. Can you move to that slide?
And now it's your Twitter and order your books on Amazon. Yes.
Oh, you sure on the that one?
Mm-hmm. That's slide number 4, I think it says.
Okay, go to number 5.
Okay, number 5 is up.
This is terrible. Okay, Negroes acknowledging your Black African ancestry and mod, not heritage. We must be race men and women proud of our culture and African Black ancestry. What is B1? B1 is unity with mod. Dr. Marie Childs has noted that Kim de Jet de Mod, to be Black, speak. You mod. Go to the next one.
You got it.
I have not done wrong. I have not robbed. I have not stolen. I have not slain people. I have not told lies. I have not stolen food. I was not sullen. I have not fornicated with the fornicator. I have not caused anyone to weep. I have not dissembled. I have not transgressed. I have not discussed secrets. I have brought no lawsuits. I have not wrongly copulated. I have not struck terror. I have not transgressed the law. I have not been hot-tempered. I have not been neglectful or truthful words. I have not cursed. I have not been violent. I have not confounded truth. I have not been impatient. I have not cursed the God. I have not made extolling or bragging. Kim de Jet de Mod. Kim de Jet de Mod. To be Black. Speak you mod. Go to the next slide.
Done.
What is FBA? FBA is not a group. FBA is not an organization. FBA is a lineage. A lineage is lineal descent from an ancestry or pedigree. As a result, we are descendants of the African and Aboriginal Blacks who built the United States. The next slide.
Next slide.
The book of Deuteronomy makes it clear FBA and FBB must honor Emma. In Deuteronomy 28:9-10, we read, "The Lord your God will bless you in the land he has given you. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath. If you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in his way, then all the peoples on earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Aden, Deuteronomy 28, 43, 52. The Aden who lives among you will rise above you higher and higher, but you will sink lower and lower. He will lend to you, but you will not lend to him. He will be the head, but you will be the tail. All these curses will come upon you. They will pursue you and overtake you until you are destroyed, because you did not obey the Lord your God and observe the commands and decrees he gave you. They will be a sign and a wonder to you and your descendants forever, because you did not serve the Lord your God joyfully and gladly in the time of prosperity. Therefore, in hunger and thirst, in nakedness and dire poverty, you will serve the enemies the Lord God sends against you. He will put an iron yoke on your neck until he has destroyed you. Isn't that what happened to the foundational Black Americans?
Absolutely.
Isn't that what happened to the foundational Black British? Yes, yes, yes. All these things came to pass. 49, the Lord will bring a nation against you from far away, from the ends of the earth, like an eagle swooping down, a nation whose language you will not understand. A fierce-looking nation without respect for the old or pity for the young. Isn't that what they did to us? Look over there. Look at that picture on the left. Look at how they beat our women. They beat our children. And you know, and what makes it so bad is that, you know, it looks like, yeah, they used to take a brother out and sometimes, you know, disembowel him or tie four horses. Sometimes they take a big strong brother like I was when I was younger. They tie one rope on his on left hand, one rope on the right hand, one rope on the left foot, one rope on the right foot, and they would pull until they could pull that man apart, because they want to instill in us fear. But think about this, family. Think about this. Mostly all their pictures are about them beating our damn women. What the?
Mm-hmm.
Beating our women all the damn time.
They have a fascination.
Throwing them out in the damn, in the pasture. Taking our children down to Florida. Using them for gator bait.
Yep. Fascination violence is what it's called.
Why?
Absolutely.
But they always want to beat our women.
And then absolutely.
You hear some brothers talking about, oh, I can't find a sister. You just don't have no Mac. You don't have no rap, you dumbass. Get that white girl to believe anything you say, and you know you're going to get a good oral sex period with her. But the whole point is this, is that a sister's worth more than a damn screw.
That's right. Say that.
A Black woman gives you satisfaction by the simple fact that she will love you. She will be with you. She's like a damn tonic. How do you mean?
Ain't no love like the love of a Black woman, brother.
How do you mean a tonic, Dr. Winters? When you become like Twitch and you wish you could talk to somebody, you can't tell her about the white man keeping you down. You can't tell her about the racism that you experience because she's white.
Mm-hmm.
But when you had a Black woman, you can tell her everything that hurts you.
Mm-hmm.
When you have that Black woman, you can tell her all the things you long for, your dreams, your desires, your dreams, everything that makes you who you are. And because she's the mother goddess, she will make it happen.
Love it, brother.
I'm not racist, but I'm just telling you, if you get with a white woman, it's death. It's death. It's death. It's death.
All facts.
I know these Black athletes, they marry a white woman, then when they run out of money and she leave her ass, then they looking for a sister.
Mm-hmm.
Just stay broke, nigga. Stay broke. You go to my damn women when you ain't got no damn cash. When you had cash, you was with Karen.
There you go. Real talk. Come on now.
You know,
we don't need to go to the next slide. This is good right here.
Yes, sirs. Go to the next slide.
All right, you're there. Number
the
nine.
Black indigenous people, native to the United States. FBA ancestry is African. FBA heritage depend on your tribal origins. Cree, Seminole, Cherokee, Catholic, Jew, Moorish, Hebrew. Aboriginal foundational Black Americans were the first slaves in the United States. Identity matters. They want to call us everything, colored, minorities, African-American. But we should call ourselves foundational Black Americans. Why? Because it's a lineage. Anybody can say they're African-American if they come from Africa. Uh-huh. One of the richest African-Americans in the United States is Elon Musk. Over 200,000 Black foundational Black Americans fought in the Civil War to free ourselves. You know, foundational Black American culture is the food, the music, the language. When they tell you that they've lost, that Black people lost their culture, that's a damn lie. The music, the food you eat over here, everything is from us. So mm-hmm. We haven't lost our culture. We might not know about our folklore and know those stories that helped us to survive in the 1930s, 40s, 50s, and 60s, but we still have a strong culture because American culture is FBA culture. All American technological advances were made by Black people. I'm not trying to be racist. I'm not trying to brag, but we done it. Black people have always been economically, you know, solvent. They want to have great cities, great towns, great business areas. And every time we build one up, the European come and he destroy it. He burn it down. Beginning in 1919, from 1919 to 1925, they tried to burn down every Black city that had anything going for it. Any mm-hmm. Black economic area they had going for it. The only place they couldn't tear down was Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't tear down Chicago in 1919 because we had, in a sense, the armory on 35th Street. And because we had the armory on 35th Street, when those white folks came to the South Side to try to kill Black people, those former soldiers that fought in World War I went and got those rifles and they shot back. They shot back. So Second Frequency ran their ass back to the North Side and they called in the National Guard to disarm us. Now they don't have any guns at the armory on 35th Street.
Mm-hmm.
They learned from that. But we were able to defend ourselves. They do not like to see a brother with a gun unless they're shooting another brother.
Mm.
Foundational Black Americans, we lost our identity. There's no, the Mongoloid Indians were not the real Indians that lived in the United States. The Mongoloid Indians, they migrated up from Mexico. And then they moved over in our areas and we gave them land. We allowed them because all they knew how to hunt was to do was hunt and fish. And that's still what the hell they only know what to do is hunt and fish. We were the five civilized tribes. We grew the damn crops. Listen, a lot of these Spanish people, a lot of these Chicanos and Mestizos, they want to tell you in a sense that they've been in America a long time. No, that's bullshit. It's a lie. You go check the census of 1860, 1870. The census, United States census, shows there was only 4,000 Spanish-speaking people in the entire United States.
Mm.
That was from Maine to California, 4,000. These other people today, they're not the original damn inhabitants of America. They're immigrants from Mexico,
mm-hmm.
from Venezuela. Stop getting food by the bullish. Stop getting food by the bullish. We're the foundational Black Americans. We were here before the Constitution was written. We was here before America was a nation. We built this country. There were many Blacks in ancient South America. Yes, yes. Go back and see my video, Exumites in Ancient America. I talk about the Mochicas. I talk about how we came over here. I talk about the writing systems. Yes, 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 yes. Look at that brother over there on the left-hand side. He's wearing a kufi hat. Yes, he was in South America wearing kufi hats.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you get my book, African Empires in Ancient America, and the world history of the Black race, but especially my book, African Empires in Ancient America, I talk about the empires. You see, when you go by, you know, Ivan Van Sertima's book, he talks about the Maya and he talks about the Olmecs. But see, what I do in my book, African Empires in Ancient America, I show that we were just not aside population. We built the damn civilizations. We had empires. Empires. What does an empire imply? An empire implies that it was more than one city, more than one town. There were black empires in ancient America. Get my book. If you want to know more, go to the next slide.
Number 14.
We have mainly talked about the Exumites in ancient South America.
That's the one.
Okay. Here you can see some, mainly in my other talks, I mainly talked about the Exumite influences in South America. The Exumites, they used the battle club in war. As a result, Exumite doctors became skilled in trepanning, or true cranial surgery, without killing the patient. In other words, in a sense, they would cut into the skull, and they were able, in a sense, to fix up that trauma that affected people's brains from being clubbed. Yes. You know, it was black people from ancient Exum, Abyssinia, who came over here, and they were ruling much of South America. Stop. Stop believing this bullish that they teach you that the black people were only in a sense the Olmec or some other people. We were all over the damn place. Get my book, African Empires in Ancient America, and you know more. This trampaigning, this operation was unknown to Europeans until after Columbus discovered America. Yet it was known to the Peruvians. Both the Peruvians and the Exumites used false heads or mummies. Let's go to the next slide. Here you can see some of the black people. These are some of the other artifacts. You know, that is one of the beautiful things about the internet today. You know, here we see other South American blacks, but today I'm going to talk about the Sumerians in South America. What you find is that they left so many monuments, but for a long time, they would only put monuments relating to ancient America that showed Mongoloid people or white people. But now a lot of scientists have done research and they want to get their research out. So they're showing the authentic pictures. And we find in a sense that when we look at the authentic pictures, we find out in a sense that there were many black people in South America. They had many empires. Stop thinking about we only contributed to civilization in ancient Americas. That's what Ivan and Renoka Rashidi talk about. We weren't contributing. We were the civilization in ancient America. Get my book, Learn the Truth. The Sumerians, they call their land, go to the next slide. Sumerians, they call their land the land Ki-Ingi, the kingdom of the rulers. These were the Sumerians. Go to the next slide, please.
Mm-hmm. 17.
Around 4,000 to 3,500 BC, a group of people entered Mesopotamia from Africa and found the civilization of Sumer. These people call themselves blackheads, Sagiga, and claim they belong to the Cushite ethnicity. You see, back in the day, they wouldn't show you these pictures of the Sumerians. They would only show you these Gutians, some light-skinned people with big old gigantic eyes. Those weren't Sumerians. They were Gutians. Next slide. Here we see Dinga Ningazinda and another leading Gudea before Enki or Anu, the great god. They always talk about the Anunnaki, and they tell you the Anunnaki came from outer space, and the Anunnaki made everybody. So this is bullshit. But black people continually teach this mess because they don't do any damn research.
Mm-hmm.
Anu, these were black people that was just ruling the world for a period of time. Next slide. The Sumerians and the Lemites came to Mesopotamia by boat. They first used these boats in the Eastern Sahara and the Red Sea, and they're analogous to Sumerian craft. Look at some of the ancient boats that you find in the rock art of ancient Africa. You see that these same boats are depicted, and here we see on this particular artifact, we see the people in a boat. We see them sailing. You see, Then we see those gates and pillars. That means they were selling to a great civilization. This is why they often build their urban centers near rivers and streams. Yes. What happened is that the Anu, they had built a wonderful civilization. The Great Flood came around 4000 BC. After the Great Flood, many Anu centers of civilization were separated from the rest of the world. So what Black people did in Africa was is that they began, in a sense, to set out. They began to set out and sail to all these earlier areas so they could rebuild the civilization that was built by the Anu. The Anu is just the name of the people we call Pygmies today. Yes. Yes, they show you these people living in the Congo, living in the forest, and you see these little miniature people, and you say, damn, what? They rule the world? Yes, they rule the world. But it's just like any time a cataclysm comes, anytime there's chaos, what do you think would happen tomorrow if we had a magnetic field? If a magnetic field occurred as a result of a reversal in the orbit of the Earth, automatically every motor, every battery would short circuit. Water would rise and cover up the University of Chicago, because most universities, it's interesting though, you know, that most universities that white people build are near water. They'll all be underwater. No books, no knowledge for them, but that's for them. Family, because your first frequency, you won't have to worry about the books in the library. You'll be able to access those records, the Akashic records, through your genetic memory, and civilization will continue. It'll take a while, because people have to start to realize that they can do things on their own instead of waiting for second frequency to lead them. That's right. Do this. Next slide. Controversy surrounding the Kushite African Black origins of the Sumerians. The controversy around the Kushite African Black origin of the Elamite, Sumerians, Akkadians, and Assyrians is simple and yet complicated. It involves both the racism exhibited toward the African slave in the Western Hemisphere and Africans generally, which led to the idea that Africans had no history. Yes, yes. I know if you guys listen to our Reverend Matthews on Sunday, he talked about the three Hegels, the three H's. He talked about how they changed how people viewed the history of the world. The three H's, what they did in a sense, they began to teach that first frequency had no history. They taught that we had no history. They taught that we were nobody. Yet they knew that civilization came from us. We made civilization.
That's right.
You know, it was Julius Oprah. He was a Jew guy. You see, and because of the fact that many of the Jews, original Jews, not the Ashkenazians, but the Sephardic Jews, most of the Sephardic Jews were descendants of the Moors that lived in Spain. And so since they were descendants of the Moors, what color were the Moors? Black, dark hue. So then therefore, most of the Sephardic Jews, in a sense, were very dark with Negroid features. And so what happened is that Julius Oprah, he wanted to create a myth. And he wanted to create the myth that all Semites, or all Semitic-speaking people, were white. And see, this was to accommodate the white ancestry of European Jews who wanted to start saying that they were the Jews and that the original Jews were white. Yes, it is a trick, but that's what people do. People, in a sense, create histories for themselves, even though it may be a lie. Let's go to the next one. You know, Giants in the Field of Sumerian Studies was Colonel Henry Rollison and also Julius Oprah. But Henry Rollison, he was a very good scholar. And what he did is that he always made sure to teach you that the Sumerians were Kushites. They were Black people. You know, as a result, Rollison was surprised during his research to discover that the founders of the Mesopotamian civilization were of Kushite origin. Yes, Kushite origin. And even at that time, they knew that the Kushites referred to those Black people that lived in what we call modern day Sudan, or Bilad el Sudan. And what Bilad el Sudan? That means in Arabic, the land of the Blacks, you see? And see, Rollison made it clear that the Semitic speaking people of Akkad and the non-Semitic speaking people of Sumer were both Black, or Negro people, who called themselves Sagiga. the black face or black head. In Rawlinson, Aryans were recognized as Akkadians or Chaldean, while the Semitic-speaking blacks were called Assyrians. Julius Opert, he noted that the original founders of Mesopotamian civilization called themselves Ki and Gi, land of the true lords. So what does Ki and Gi mean? It means land of the true lords or civilized lands. But see, he didn't want people to know that. He wanted to call them in a sense, you know, he wanted to, in a sense, give the Sumerians the Semitic name. Next slide. And see, the Assyrians, they called the Ki and Gi, you see, they called him Semiritu, Sumeritu. And it's the Sumeritu or Sumerian that we call the people who live in this part of Mesopotamia. Right here, you can see the Assyrian king Esarhaddon. Okay, in the past, they never used to show this picture of the Assyrian king Esarhaddon. You see, they would show a lot of different artifacts. One of the things that you have to understand, family, is that many of the monuments that they say relate to the Assyrian people that you find in museums like at the Oriental Institute, or if you find in the Museum of Art in New York, or you know, over in France, or the museum in London, a lot of those are made up artifacts. Yes, they're made up. You see, they created artifacts. Just like when they show you statues in museums of how the Greeks were supposed to be. They didn't find those. There ain't no statues coming from the Greek period. When they show statues of these of people having sex with each other and all that, a lot of that stuff is made up. A lot of the things they teach you as history are not. It's not really history. It's something that they made up to trick you. The Assyrians called the Ki and Gi people Sumeritu, the sacred language. Opert popularized the Assyrian name Sumer for the original founders of this civilization. Thus, we have today the Akkadians and Sumerians of ancient Mesopotamia. Let's go to the next slide. It is strange to some observers that Opert never criticized Rawlinson, who had proposed the Turanian origin of the Ki and Gi, Sumerians. But this is not strange at all. Opert did not attack Rawlinson, who was still alive at the time, because he knew that Rawlinson said the Sumerians were the original Scythic and Turanian people. He called Cushites. You know, a lot of times when you read these things, they talk about the Scythic people. Now, today, they'll show you pictures of the Scythic people and say that they were white. No, they were. That was another name for the Cushites. But again, like I said, is that unless you can find the terms, somebody brought that up in class this week. Unless you look at the original terms or names used by the ancient people, it'll be very difficult to discover their true identity, you see, because they hide the identity, so you will not be able to see that these people were black, just like you, family, just like me, just like us. Moreover, Rawlinson made it clear that both the Akkadians and Sumerians were blacks. For Opert to have debated this issue with Rawlinson, who deciphered the cuneiform script, would have meant that he would have had to accept the fact that the Semites were black. There was no way Opert would have wanted to acknowledge his African heritage, given the anti-Semiticism experienced by Jews living in Europe, of course. He didn't want to go around and say that his granddaddy was black. See? But see, they were able to whiten up. It's just like when I was growing up. You know, as I tell you guys, you know, my mother was dark, my father was light, my mother and them, they were mainly from the Choctaw, my grandmother too, I think. But my father's side of the family was very light skinned, you know. And you know, they could pass, and some of them could even pass for white. And my auntie, Aunt Mabel, she couldn't pass for white, but she was very, 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 very beautiful. And they wanted her to play in movies back in the 30s. Very beautiful woman, you know. That's what spoiled me, to always think about beautiful women. So anyway, I digress.
Let's move on.
The Sumerian, Dravidian, and African speakers originated in the Fertile African Crescent, yes, which were the highland regions of Middle Africa. These people belonged to the Ma clan. I'm going to talk about the Ma Confederation in the future. The Ma Confederation was the name of the major Paleo-African clan during the last great wet period in Saharan history, 5,000 to 3,000 years before Christ. The Ma Confederation includes the Egyptian, the Lamanites, Dravidian, Mandean, and Sumerians. We call members of this civilization Proto-Saharan to denote their ethnic origin. they added the term Ma. Remember, we talked last week about Ma and Ma, 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 to their ethnonyms, e.g., the Mandan called themselves Mainde, the children of Ma, and the Sumerians called themselves Makgari, exalted God's children. I discussed this great African civilization in my book, Before Egypt, the Ma Confederation, Africa's first civilization. The Sumerians were in control of Mesopotamia for many years. Then around 2334 BC, a group of Pontai speakers called Akkadians under Namrin Sin, or Sargon of Akkad, took over Mesopotamia. The most famous king of Sumer was King Gilgamesh. The first king to unify much of Sumer, though, was Mislim, who took the title King of Kish around 2500 BC. The second famous leader of Sumer was Gudea. That's supposed to be a depiction of Gudea on the right-hand side. But most of the time, most of the pictures of Gudea, they try to depict him, you know, as fake. You know, the French, they like to turn black people into white. And a lot of the artifacts that they show in their museums are complete forgeries. They're just made up-ish. Okay, Gudea is the best known for his trade expeditions and unification of Sumer. He's also said to obtain craftsmen from Susa and a lamb for the decoration of temples for his people. Here's a picture of one of the great rulers, or Sargon. By 2380 BC, the Semitic people took control of Sumer. The Semitic speakers were led by Sargon the Great. It was Sargon who unified all of Sumer. Sargon, who had once been the cupbearer of the king of Ur, Zababa, one of the kings of Kish, he was also a great military leader and builder of the unified state of Sumer Akkad. The capital of Sargon's empire was Agade, Akkad of the Bible. And this is supposed to be a depiction of Sargon. I don't know. The Canaanites and Sumer. The fact that the Sumerians and Akkadians were Africoid or black is best indicated by the artworks from Ur, Tel Adma, or Eridu. Indo-European rulers of Lagash and Larsa tried to imitate Sumerian styles, but many of them were Gudeans and therefore not of Kushite origin. It is interesting to note that the Mesopotamian king list does not recognize many of the enseeds of Lagash. The Gudeans ruled Lagash until Uthahigo, king of Erech, conquered Trigan, the last Gudean king. It's very important to understand that many of the Gudeans, whenever you get a book, like if you did a Google search right now, they would show you some people with some big eyes. And these are not really Sumerians. The Sumerians look like you. They look like me, look like us. But these people, in a sense, because they're light-skinned and they were Gudeans, and they didn't even rule Sumer, you know, for an extended period of time. But they always put them in the books, these Gudeans, and they say that these were the Sumerians. No, they're not. They're Gudeans. They're recognized as white, barbarian people that lived in the mountains. The Canaanites invaded Mesopotamia from Arabia. They occupied Palestine and Phoenicia. In the ancient literature, the Canaanites were called Martu or Amorites. The most famous Canaanite ruler of Mesopotamia was Hammurabi. Next slide. You know, a lot of people, have seen the Sumerian handbag. Here we see some Sumerian supposed to be gods. And you see they carry this handbag. This handbag is very interesting. And I just wanted to tell you what it means. The Sumerian gods and leaders are associated with a handbag. This handbag is made up of numerous proto-Sumerian signs. The figures carry the bag with a hoop. See that hoop that they, no, that's what they hold it with. The hook is connected to the bag by two circular signs ta. You can see the two circular signs that connect the hook to the bag, which means ta. And the bag was shaped like a box. And the box in proto Sumerian is Po. So thusly the handbag reads Atata Po. Or this is what that bag means. That handbag, when you read the signs that it's composed of, it reads, happiness unites the supporter of the pure mystic order. You see, in other words, you know, as me and you know, Reverend Dr. Matthews has tried to tell you, is that First Frequency has always been a very religious people. We've always, in a sense, wanted to always stay in contact with our creator, Amma. And then we've always, in a sense, wanted to recognize our relationship to a higher authority. And that's one of the reasons why they carry this handbag This handbag relates to, in effect, the senses that, that they are supporters, but they're supporters of the mystic order or the cult or the so-called religion. Esther and Kramer and the Sumerians claimed that Makan was Egypt, Maluha was Nubia Punt, and Indus Valley was Delmun. This is how S.M. Kramer and the Sumerians, this map kind of shows you Magan, which is Egypt, Maluha, which would be what we call modern Ethiopia, Somalia today. And then we see Sumer and Mesopotamia. Then we see Dilmun was what we call the Indus Valley civilization, you see. And so, you know, a lot of people used to go to Dilmun because they used to like to go get lapis lazuli, you know. And this is what made Dilmun famous. So as you can see, you know, they always make you think that there was no connections among Black people. Black people just isolated. Black people was just wandering, waiting for the white man to find them. No, that's a lie. We already had our civilizations. Most modern scholars such as Joanne Oakes in Babylon suggest that Magan, Egypto-Nubia, and Luha Punt were southeastern Arabia and the Meccan coast to as far as the Indus Valley. In other words, a lot of times they want to say that Magan, Luha, they want to take everything out of Africa and put it over in what they call Asia. It's all bullshit. What'd you say? It's all bullshit. What? Don't say that. It is. It's all a lie. You know. From the time of Sargon the Great, 2334 BC, down to the first millennium BC, Magan and Maluha was Egypto-Nubia and Punt or Ethiopia, respectively. According to these records, ships from Maluha and Magan brought trade goods to Mesopotamia. You know, we were not in isolation. We used to go on the sea. They teach you now, oh, Black people don't like to swim. Black people don't swim. They scared of the water. Oh, you liars. We made the boats. We invented swimming. We invented, in a sense, riding on boats, building boats. And they teach you a lie. Next slide. Okay, but what we know is that many of Sumerians went to South America. The reason that we know that they were in South America is the Fuente Magna bowl. I translate this bowl way back in the 90s. Anytime you go on an article, anytime you just put in Google the Fuente Magna bowl, they're gonna say Dr. Clyde went as a disciple. Oh yes, I did. I discipled it. Because see, most white people, they want to teach you that the Sumerians only wrote in cuneiform. They didn't just write in cuneiform. They used, in a sense, a syllabic script, which was Proto-Sumerian, just like Proto-Elamite. They called it in some of the second frequency. They acknowledge this writing system. They called it linear Sumerian or linear Elamite. I just call it Proto-Sumerian. The Fuente Magna Bowl and Pocatilla Monument indicates that Sumerians formerly lived in South America. Yes, the Sumerians, that great people that lived in Mesopotamia, they also lived in South America. The possibility that the writing on the Fuente Magna Bowl was used by Sumerians and the identification of Sumerian place names on the Altiplano suggests that Bolivia and Peru may represent the Tin Land of the West or the Sunset Land of Sumerian inscriptions, yes. Many Sumerian inscriptions talk about it was a land in the west or the sunset land, and it was here that they could get tin to sell. The Sumerians mentioned a land in the west called Kugaki, where they mined valuable metals. Dr. A.H. Sacy said that the tin land in Sumerian was called Kugaki. Sacy made it clear that Sumerians claimed that they obtained tin from this land. This map is a map where I try to show you where Kugaki was. As you can see, Kugaki is near Cusco, Nanasca, and also Lake Titicaca, Tiwanaku, and other areas, but it's mainly around this whole area that we call today Bolivia and Peru. And this is what I believe was Kugaki. And I'm going to tell you why now. Lake Titicaca, Sassy believed that Kugaki was probably located in Spain. That's where he thought it was, but it was further west. You see, it was in Bolivia. The presence of the Fuente Magna Bowl suggests that Kugaki was in South America instead of Spain. Since Kugaki was west of the Mediterranean, it was probably the name for some region in North or South America because the Americas lie west of the Mediterranean Sea, right? while Spain lies on the Mediterranean, right? See, Mediterranean is right, you know, it's right on the Mediterranean Sea. So the tin land had to be further west. And the further west you go from the Mediterranean is what? South America, Mexico, et cetera. A.H. Burrell and R. Burrell in America's Ancient Civilizations and J. Bailey in Sailing to Paradise maintain that the area around Lake Titicaca may have been called Lake Manu by the Sumerians. According to the Burrells and Bailey, traditions claim that Sumerians made many visits to the land west of the Mediterranean, which they called the Kugaki. The traditions make it clear that Sumerians sailed to Kugaki in their Magur boats. Cuneiform tablets make it clear that Magur boats could carry 18 to 5 metric tons of precious metals. Look at this. Here you can see Bolivia and Peru. And as you can see, many of the place names around here, you know, are very interesting. And some of them even relate to the fact of Oro or Uru, which the Sumerians used to identify cities. Let's go to the next slide. The Sumerians probably first made contact with Kugaki via the Atlantic currents that take you from Africa to Brazil. Prospectors probably reached Brazil and sailed down the Amazon River until they found large tin deposits in Bolivia and Peru. The major center for mining in Bolivia and Peru is a place called Potosi. You know, it's very interesting to me. Sometimes I really wonder, you know, I even wonder today, I wonder how, you know, what is it about, what are the geological features that allow people to tell that tin or iron or copper is found in a place? I don't know if they just come off, if they just go off intuition, or they're just able in a sense to just, there's certain geological features in the soil or whatever to identify these areas as places where you can find these various metals. But again, that's something, I'm not a geologist, so I couldn't know. But again, we feel that they were brought over to Brazil, around in a sense, through the various currents in the Atlantic Ocean. And then they went down the Amazon River, and then they got down to the tin area of Bolivia, Peru, which I believe they call Kugaki. Let's go to the next slide. Once they established mining operations in Kugaki, local people probably began to work in the mining operations and adopted many Sumerian customs. Linguistic terms and the social terminology and the social technology of writing, i.e. the Proto-Sumerian script. This means that writing has a long tradition among the people of Bolivia, Peru. You know, in my book, The Sumerians in South America, what I show in this book, and you may want to buy this, is that I show you that the ancient Inca and the Pocatilla monument all have these Proto-Sumerian signs. And this shows in a sense that when they teach you that the people in a sense in South America only had the rope script or whatever, quipus, only had quipus. No, that was wrong. They had a linear written script. And I've been able, in a sense, to discuss these various writing systems in my book, South Ancient Scripts in South America. Get that book if you want to find out more about the literacy of these Black people who ruled in South America. As I told you before, you see, stop this whole idea. Get out of your mind what Renoka Rashidi said. Renoka Rashidi, him and Ivan, they said, oh, it was some Black people. They came down there and they contributed. These Black people, in a sense, they came among the Mongoloid people. But the Mongoloid people developed civilization? No. They had it all wrong. Black people invented the civilizations. The Mongoloid Indians copied off them. That's why when you read my book, The Sumerians in South America, that's why you find out the writing systems they used. We are very mighty, mighty, mighty intellectual and intelligent people.
Facts.
Next slide. The Andes was the tin land of Kugaki of the Sumerians. The Andes mountains were called Antis. Very important, I repeat. The Andes mountains were called Antis. This area was formerly called Antisuyo, or the kingdom of the Antis. This was also the homeland of the Antis Indians. In the Quechua language spoken by many Indians in the area, Antis means copper. Antis was also the name for the native people who formerly lived in this part of South America. So again, we see that at Cougar Key, we see that these people, in a sense, they called the area copper area, and this would have copper or in a sense tin too. And so then we find, in a sense, that this would go right along with the fact that the Sumerians said they knew a land called Cougar Key, where copper and tin was mined. Antes is probably of non-Quechua origin. The Chapaya language, another Native American language spoken in the area, is different from Quechua and Aymara. Some researchers claim Chapaya is closely related to the Maya language, which are spoken in Mexico. I've never compared Chapaya and Mayan, so I couldn't really say. This part of Bolivia is famous for the rich minerals found in the area. Many of these metals are found at the Bolivian Altiplano near Lake Pupo, an inland sea which was formerly connected to the Pacific Ocean by rivers, now dried up. Next slide. The Bolivian Altiplano is the largest plain in the world. It contains two inland seas, Lake Titicaca and Lake Pupo. This area high in the Andes Mountains makes it an apt location for Lake Manu, or the Cloud Lake of the Sumerians, where metals were mined in the Mounds of Sunset, the land situated west of the Mediterranean Sea. In other words, Cougar Key was, in a sense, the area where the Sumerians got their minerals from. But they said they called, in a sense, the area in which they got these metals Lake Manu, or the Cloud Lake. And so then, given the fact, in a sense, that we find Lake Titicaca and Lake Pupo in this mountainous area, wouldn't that relate to Manu or Cloud Lake? Because it's high in the mountains, just as the Sumerians, these black people, described the area where they got their metals from. Lake Pupo is 50 miles, 80 kilometers long. The lake was surrounded by mounds on all sides and canals. Satellite pictures indicate that deep canals formerly existed near Lake Pupo. It is a shallow lake a few feet deep. Lake Pupo is a salty sea, sometimes known to dry up. Lake Titicaca and Lake Pupo are connected by the river Desaguadero. The companion lake of Pupu was Lake Uru. The city of Oruro is located near Lake Uru. Very interesting. Very interesting that we find Lake Uru and we find Oruro. And the reason that it makes this very interesting is because these are the Sumerian words that relate to Uru. Because Uru was a Sumerian word for, in a sense, city. And here's a map of Bolivia and a map of Peru. And you can see where we can see Oruro. Do you see Oruro down on that map? And so you can see in this other areas too that have that prefix O-R-U or U-R-U, which relate in a sense to Sumerian words. And one of the greatest centers was Potosi. Next slide. The metals found near Lake Pupo include copper, tin, gold, and silver. Here we find metals being extracted in the cities of Oruro and Corocoro. See that at the end of those words? Oruro, Uaro, Corocoro, Oaro. You see how we find, in a sense, that there's a suffix at the end of those words that means what? City in Sumerian. And here's where they found gold and copper, you know, were mined. The name for these cities suggests a Sumer origin. In Sumerian, the name for city is Uru. The suffix is O-R-O for the cities around Lake Pupo is strikingly similar to U-R-O, U-R-U. It is also interesting to note that a major center in this area for mining is Potosi. Potosi is famous for its tin deposits. At Potosi, we find the Potosi Mountains, which is made of solid tin. I repeat, the Potosi Mountain was made of solid tin. It was called Mount Catavi. Next slide. This is what the Spanish used to talk about Potosi. I don't like to talk about mining. I don't like to talk about the Spanish mining, because the Spanish and Portuguese, they had a lot of enslaved people working these mines. And what they would do is that they would work you to death, literally. They would work people to death and then just buy some new slaves as they died. So it was, these were very horrible places during slavery. But we're not talking about slavery. I digress. We're talking about, in a sense, the you know, Sumerian period. The Potosi era was a major center of mining. In the 1550s, the Spanish began to exploit the silver found at Potosi Hill. The Spanish called Potosi Hill Cerro Rico, or Rich Mountain. As a result of the Spanish attempt to fully exploit the riches in this area, a horrific, and I do mean an horrific number of Indians died in the mines and black people. Hugh Thompson in The White Rock and Exploration of the Inca Heartland vividly describes this tragedy. Thompson says that, and I quote, "The mine consumed the labor force of Bolivia's Altiplano. If they didn't die, they were ground down by the apology for a wage that was paid to them. Within a generation, the population of those parts of the Altiplano used for mine conscription was halved. Yes, halved. Thousands, thousands of people just died in the mines. Within another generation, it had halved again, and still Potosi continued to extract its quotas." So as you can see, it was a terrible place. But that's the way second frequency is. They have no idea. They have no care. What did the book of Deuteronomy say? They will send you to a people who cannot feel. They can't feel your pain. They don't see anything in hurting you. They don't see anything in hurting you then and hurting you today. Clyde Winters, Dr. Clyde Winters deciphered the Sumerian inscriptions in South America. In addition to affinity between the symbols found on the Pocotilla Monument and Fuente Magna Bow and Incan weaving, we also find that these symbols are identical to signs engraved on Moshi bricks. A common feature of Huanca, or carved Inca stones, are steps cut into the rock. Okay, here you can see the, on the right hand, left hand side, we see the Poca, we see in a sense the Fuente Magna Bow, and the other one is the Pocatilla. And I've deciphered these inscriptions. I'm not going to talk about these now. I'm going to do a presentation later on the relationship between the Sumerians at Tiwanaku. And then I'm going to go into these inscriptions and tell you what these black people, the messages that they left us. Clyde Winters in Ancient Scripts in South America, the Sumerians in South America, has shown that the Inca throne, an immaculately carved set of shallow steps, is similar to Proto-Saharan signs. Other signs from Huacas, or carved stones at Rodat, Dero Hill, and the white stone at Chuquipalta, relate strikingly to the writing found on the Pocatilla and Fuente Magna bowls. Next slide. So again, if you want to find out about this writing, and see that there was true literacy. Yes, it was true literacy in South America. Stop believing all this ish that these second frequency teachers, they teach you lies. Because see, they don't do the research, they don't know how to do the research. But see, that's why we're developing in my class people who are going to go and look at the evidence. They're going to look at the hands-on evidence and determine what is the truth about our history, just like I did in my book, Ancient Scripts in South America, the Sumerians in South America. Aymara, that's a language spoken still in the Andes. They have many words that relate to Sumerian. In this region where Kugaki probably existed in South America, we have the Aymara language. Aymara terms relate to Sumerian terms. This is not surprising given the decipherment of the Pocatilla statue and the Magna Fuente Bow. These documents indicate that the Sumerians had established many aspects of their religion in Bolivia. The linguistic evidence supports the view that the Sumerians living in Kugaki were miners, yes. The Sumerian term for copper was Urudu. This term agrees with the Mayan term for gold, or Uri, and copper, Antai Yauri. The similarity between Urudu and Yauri and Uri suggests that the Sumerians may have been the first people in the era to exploit the metals found throughout the Titicaca area in Bolivia. On the right-hand side, you can see a word list. You know, you can see the similarities between the Mara words and Sumerian words, you know. Very interesting. Next slide. Okay. In summary, the presence of Sumerian terms in the Aymara language, Sumerian place names, and Sumerian writing on the Fuente Magna Bowl and Pocatilla statue make it obvious that Sumerian civilization was formerly widespread in South America. This leads me to believe that Bolivia and Peru were Kugaki, the tin land of the West, mentioned in Sumerian inscriptions. These are some Sumerian elites, you know, I wrote about it, translate their tablets, that's it. You can find out more about the African empires in South America by reading my books, African Empires in Ancient America, get that book. And of course, my book, The World History of the Black Race, you're gonna find information in there about these ancient civilizations in South America and Mexico. If you wanna learn more about this particular topic, the Sumerians, get my book, The Cushites, Who, What, When, Where. This book will tell you about the Cushites who include the Sumerians. You wanna find out more about the ancient scripts, then get the Sumerians in South America. And also, this week's PDF, History Gems with Dr. Clyde Winters, this will outline the history of some of the Sumerians in South America. Because again, I tell you, I'm gonna do a presentation on Tiahuanaca, but in this PDF, you're gonna learn everything possible about the Sumerians and how they ruled in South America. So get this PDF. You know, you're gonna wanna read it, you're gonna wanna see it, you're gonna wanna know it, because this tells you about those Black people who ruled in that area. Thank you.
Wow, wow, wow. Absolutely amazing, Doc. Incredible work. As always. Always over delivering. I appreciate that.
Well, like I said, that's just the first one. You know, next week I'm thinking about talking about Nimrod. Mm. Show you how the Nimrod of the Bible, and how he really existed.
Mm-hmm.
But again, like I said, it's very important to understand. And we get back to the grassroots history. See, grassroots historians, you know, like Drusilla Dungy.
Mm-hmm.
Dungy, and she was the first person to write about Caucasian, about the Cushites, and she was a Black woman. Mm-hmm. Then we see Zora Neale Hurston, and so it's just this prejudice, because see, for some reason, many Black women at that time, you know, who really wrote about our history, what made them so important is that they had that high self-esteem.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm,
and I think a lot of that high self-esteem and love of their people came from the fact is that our women were treated so bad. Foundational Black American women, foundational Black British women were treated so bad by Europeans that they loved themselves, and they were somehow able to connect with that Black African ancestry.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They had self-esteem and love of themselves and their Blackness. And this is so beautiful. So that's why I hope that many of you out there will read Drusilla Dungy's book on the Cushites. You know, read her book. Read some of the research of Zora, you know, Neale Hurston. Read these books, because these books are authentic books that relate to our culture.
Mm-hmm.
Not that boule-ish that you're gonna get from just reading these people who talk about these Black elites. Yeah, we know their family had money. In fact, I'm a grassroots historian because, you know, I didn't have no preachers in my family. I didn't have no big shots in my family. Mm-hmm. My father had a fourth grade education. My mom a fourth grade education.
Wow. Yep. Something about Chicago. Our parents, that's what happened with mine. Same thing.
Something in the water, baby. Something. Look what happened to you. They told you that you were special education. They told you couldn't learn ish.
Yes.
And today, you're doctor.
Look at the gun.
You can't keep a brother down, and you can't keep a sister down.
No, you cannot.
That's one thing. No, don't make make those women mad. You see what
happened?
Brothers out there protesting left and right. They shot about 20 of them Negroes. But when that sister went out there in the Sudan, she changed the world. Don't make a sister mad. She ain't going to give up. You might whip a brother's ass and he might say, well, hey, I give up. don't make a woman mad. They're not giving up. Look down there.
Dr. Winters, I got a question for you in the audience.
Yeah.
I'm going to put it up on the screen here. Katrina Prater, one of our regulars. Welcome back, Katrina. She says, excuse me, Dr. Winters, where is ancient white history dating back hundreds of thousands of years, similar to the worldwide black history that you teach? Does it exist?
No, it exists in the caves. But, no, I'm sorry, they don't. No white civilization has lasted longer than 200 years. And they have 200 years of growth and 100 years of expansion. It happened with ancient Greece when the white people took over. It happened in ancient Rome when the white people took over. Britain ruled the world. Britain, in a sense, their civilization expanded for maybe 100 years in building. They ruled the world for about 100 years. Then they went in decline. Now America, their stepchild, they ruled the world for they built themselves up for 100 years. They ruled the world for approximately 100 years, and now they're in decline. See, the European, in a sense, he gets arrogant. He gets arrogant, and he doesn't fulfill the promises. There's a chapter in the Quran called The People of the Cave. And in this chapter in the Quran, it tells about how God promised them that they would rule the world, how they would go around the world with a Bible in one hand and a sword behind their back. And God blesses every people. But the only problem is that America has not lived up to its promises to the Almighty Allah. Mm-hmm. You know, like today, we don't have even freedom. We don't have, in a sense, free medical care. You know, like right now, the people in Congress, the Republicans want to take away Social Security or try to take away that medical thing, Blue Cross, whatever that's not Blue Cross, Blue Shield, whatever it is, the medical thing that's government, you know.
Medi-Cal?
Yeah, Medicare. Medicare.
Yeah, Medicare. Mm-hmm.
And all that type of stuff. When all they had to do is they could cut some money from the military budget. Because all that military budget, most of that money is not going to our military.
Mm-hmm.
The soldiers in the military, a lot of those families are living off food stamps.
Mm-hmm.
All that money in the military budget, it goes to these manufacturers, these people who manufacture weapons. You know, I think I read somewhere where they're paying $1,000 for one nail.
Unbelievable.
$1,000 for a nail is unbelievable. But again, in a sense, so America hasn't lived up to his promise. So, you know, God let you rule, and he take away the rule. But see, look at this. Egypt lasted at least over almost 4,000 years.
Yeah, that's insane. Wow.
The Moors ruled in Europe for 1,000 years almost.
Mm-hmm.
1111 to 1492.
Wow.
But Rome, 200 years, Greece, 200 years, and then Greece, Rome, they rise up, and then they become a haven for homosexuality. Then they decline. The Greeks, they rise up, homosexuality, then they decline. I'm not saying that homosexuality is the cause.
But you're not giving birth to enough people to keep the population alive. That's called birth dearth and fertility replacement.
That's right. Like today, I was listening to NPR, and it was talking about the beginning of the attack on abortion, and talking about the fact that the first attacks on abortion began in 1860.
Mm-hmm.
This doctor in 1860, he wanted to attack abortions for two reasons. One, he wanted to be able, in a sense, to knock the midwives out, so midwives couldn't make money. And two, they were afraid the white population was going to decline. Because the Chinese was coming up, we was having babies aplenty, and we still have babies aplenty. They try to kill us, we still we're at least 100 million here. But anyway,
but then
they began in the 1860s to be against abortion. Then that turned into eugenics when they started trying, in a sense, to sterilize people. Even today, the biggest argument today that led to the Supreme Court taking away the right for abortion was what? What do they call it? The white replacement theory?
Yeah, I'm actually going to be lecturing on that Sunday. Yeah.
Can you tell them?
Well, you know the shooter, the Buffalo shooter, and his manifesto. He wrote about that and talked about that white replacement theory, displacement theory. It's all based on genetic annihilation. Now, it's interesting because as I look at this birth dearth that the entire planet is under, second frequency, I move the Eurasian are dying off in record numbers. They say in 30 years, Japan will cease to exist. They're the first to be, if you will, wiped off the face of the map. And, you know, the second frequency Amu are just feeling, they're feeling it, but they don't know why, and they don't know what. They just feel that the between other religions, the Jews, the Blacks, the Latinx, everything is coming along to erase or challenge whiteness. Because as you die off, so does the power of whiteness. So does the power of white supremacy. And so they're feeling displaced. And that's why you're seeing these cats, you know, climbing up, you know, state capitol walls on, you know, January 6th insurrection. You're going to see more of this. And so there's a book by Resmaa Menakem called The Quaking of America that is absolutely insanely powerful, must read. And he goes in and talks about how this white fear, I think it was Roland Martin wrote a book called White Fear. And in his book, he talks about that they have the elites as well as the middle class and the lower class whites. They're all feeling some sense that something is after them and there's a genetic annihilation. Now, the other part of that is not just that they're declining in terms of their numbers. There's reasons for that. Actually, I've got about probably 15 reasons listed that I'm going to put in my book. But one of them is homosexuality, that as a result, they're not having more kids. Another reason that they worked so hard, even though they failed to keep white women barefoot and pregnant, is because the moment that Women's Lib came on board, women stopped having children and started working, started having independence and having multiple partners and waiting later in life to marry and have kids. So that contributes to the birth dearth as well.
That's right.
Then there's the drug part, the substance abuse. So because of the depression and the oppression and the overall sense of doom or precipitate, they have their own ghosting trauma. Now, how that's manifested is the wealthy whites, they deal with their depression with opioids. The poor whites deal with their depression with meth. So that's killing them off as well. So they're always overdosing, having mass suicide and suicide. Japan has the highest suicide rate in the world. They are killing themselves off. The young people are killing themselves off like crazy. It's insane.
Yeah, and see, a lot of women don't understand is that when you have a lot of sexual partners, you have chlamydia, and that chlamydia, chlamydia in a sense, it causes it develops in a sense a fever around the womb, and you can't become pregnant. You see,
so then,
a lot of people don't understand that it's a reason why men could have two or three wives, and women in a sense didn't have multiple husbands. Not just because of the fact that you want to know where your children came from, but it's a factor in the sense that each sperm is different. Even when women wash up, any woman who's really had any type of problems, they'll tell you that the average woman cannot use the same towel that she used to wipe her anus to wipe her vagina. A lot of times that can cause irritation. It can cause some type of a deep
infection. So,
so what I'm saying is this is that. Is that all this? And then also, you know, they were paying in a sense the Chinese to develop that venom over there in China, mm-hmm. so it could maybe kill off a certain group of people, but then when they released the venom over here, it mainly killed you know, Hispanics and second frequency.
Mm-hmm. I have the proof of that. I did a work lecture on that. Absolutely.
That's right. Yeah. But now it is now this new venom, this new booster. It looks as though it is affecting many young black people.
You know, it's designed to kill. I mean, the venom, the whole system is designed to kill. I just I just watched a 60 Minutes piece on the population, and you know, the UN came out and said that the 8th billionth person was birthed in November 2022. So they are systematically they're even trying to put various different aspects of this in the food supply so that we consume it, rather than if you don't want to take the jab, we're going to put it in your food supply, your water supply. We're going to kill off as many of you as we possibly can, not knowing that that's autogenocide and it's going to backfire. It always does.
It always backfires.
Never works.
And they're so upset. The World Health Organization, they're so upset that the Muslims and Africa, they don't have any venom over there.
Right.
You know, there's no venom there, and they wouldn't give them the venom for free, so they didn't have the venom to take. And now there's no venom, except in South Africa, where would they mm-hmm. have a large Caucasian population. But again, like I said, is that it's, you know, God is great. God wills. And see, that's the whole point. The Moors ruled for almost 1,000 years. The British mm-hmm. and Americans, they barely made 200, and they're totally in decline.
Mm-hmm.
Because the
mm-hmm.
fact is that you got to share. You got to share. What did mm-hmm. the Moors bring to Europe? They brought toothpaste. They brought cleanliness. They're the ones mm-hmm. that stopped the surge of the Black Death. They brought in a sense, they built the first hospitals, the first universities, mm-hmm. you know, and they were giving stuff to the people, and they were able to rule for 1,000 years. Mm-hmm. Then God, in a sense, Ammon gave the European a chance to rule civilization, and he just fucked it up. Excuse me. He mm-hmm. fucked it up.
Mm-hmm. No, seriously, he fucked it up. I'll back that sentiment. No, he did.
Yeah.
And that's our issue. As I said, we are like Joey on the handlebars going off the cliff. Black people, we got to get off of Joey's handlebars, because we don't even have a vehicle where we can stop our bike and not go over. We're on Joey's handlebars, and we're going to be going face first over this cliff, because we know where they're going. They're going away. And they, you know, when they die, they don't multiply. When we die, we multiply. So as a result, you have to understand, if you're going to be around, if you're going to have a full faculty of your mind, and this is not just for your kids, really, this, what Dr. Winters is doing and what I'm doing, this is for your grandbabies. This is for your, because you're not going to be here. They are, and they're going to have to deal with this, and they need a blueprint. They're going to need some information. They're going to need some scholarship of what to do when the Amu, I sound like one of those wrestlers. What are you going to do when the Amu goes wild on you, right? So you got to be prepared and prepare as you become an ancestor, you got to prepare your people.
And see, and you have to promote racial self-esteem. When the end comes to the European civilization, and the end will come. The end will come. I'm not gonna go into that. I'm not gonna talk about the apocalypse. I'm not gonna talk about the magnetic reversals that's gonna happen in a few years. I'm not gonna talk about none of that stuff.
Thanks for not talking about it and not bringing it up. Yeah, we feel a lot better and safer now, Doc.
I'm not gonna, because it doesn't matter.
Oh, I'm not gonna talk about when the asteroid comes in and kills everybody. I'm not gonna talk about that.
You're making me want to talk, but I'm not. I'm not gonna go there. But what I want to tell you is this is that. you know, just like we have those hero grassroots historians, researchers like Zora Neale Hurston, Jackson, and Jay Rogers. We have to make our children, the grandchildren, they have to be B1 because we have went through those experiences many times. We went through many Holocausts. We've been in a sense, we went through slavery, went through the Great Flood. And what did God say to fire next time? We're going to go to bed. But see, don't fear that bullshit. Because see, as long as we get our children to be able to be B1, they're going to be able to access the Akashic Records.
That's right.
Because they're going to be able to access the Akashic Records, they're going to think of ways to make civilization work for us.
We're the only ones that can save us. We're the only ones that can save us. I think it was John Henry Clark says, there's no European method, I'm paraphrasing, no European methodology to help African methodology. See, it's insane.
But see, them, it's insane. When they don't have their computer chips, when they don't have their libraries, they're not going to be able to do nothing if there are some of these cataclysms that people predict. Because of the fact that we're B1, then your children, my grandchildren, they're going to be able to access those records, and they're going to think about, damn, this is like what we can do. White men be saying, we don't have no engines, we don't have no damn construction, we don't have no cranes, we don't have no concrete. Hold up. Did they build a damn pyramid?
Right.
Yeah. Stop it. You know, we build the pyramids because we're
working. What time is it? Okay, that's, see, every time, all the time, where's your medication? Go get your medicine now. Let's go get his medicine. Yeah, I'm 100% behind you. All of the research and data absolutely, unequivocally supports everything that you're talking about. And that's why we have to do what, that's why we're doing what we're doing, to be able to educate, you know, illuminate and emancipate our people. But if you don't do it in a B1 mindset, you're going to get caught up. You're going to get caught up, swept away, and you're going to become extinct. That's really what we're dealing with, extinction protocol. Autogenocide is an extinction protocol. You know, it's a population that is so self-centered, so have such alarming levels of hubris and arrogance and ego that they will end up literally, like I talked about what we call the three sides. Suicide, homicide, and genocide. That's all they know. That's all they know. And all we do is try to live our best and greatest life and give thanks and honks to Amma and our ancestors. So we're diametrically different from this group, fam. And I know some of us are mixed. I know some of you are in, you know, intercultural relationships and what have you. And you know, as the kids say, it is what it is, you know, but help yourself, you know, help yourself and then help somebody. So you've got to put the oxygen mask on first before you can help someone else. That oxygen mask is knowledge. Then take this knowledge and apply it.
I don't know. Obviously God has made it, Emma has made it so that we will survive.
So oh yeah.
Those other people, they ride off our back, but we will survive.
No doubt.
What is this? Is that
you? What's that song? Glory again. I will survive. Go ahead and sing.
I will survive. But anyway, we will survive. We will overcome. But that's why you have to want to seek out the real history, and that's what I'm trying to tell you. That's why we're doing this, because we want to ignite within you a fire, and we want that fire to not only burn within you, but to burn in your children and your grandchildren.
And because of social epigenetics, this is already being passed down to your children.
That's right.
Just because of social epigenetics, just because this broadcast aired, that's social epigenetics. Somebody's going to see this, they're going to show their children, and boom, that child then has, because everything that Clyde is doing, everything that I'm doing, we're always pulling and pulling down from the Akashic records to bring this and synthesize it and bring it to the community.
Yeah, because you remember, only 3% of your DNA, only 3% of your DNA is programmed. 97% is junk DNA. It's mm-hmm. not junk. Mm-hmm. It's waiting to be, in a sense, imprinted by your experiences. And that's why social epigenetics, people didn't understand this for a long time, but that's why social epigenetics plays an important role in how we develop as a people and a community.
Absolutely. 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 I love our talks, my good beloved and family. This is the part of the show, the part of the lesson plan where Dr. Winters kind of disappears, because I'm going to ask him, hey, Doc, do you want to do the affirmation of power and protection? See, something happens where, you know, his shoulder just goes numb, and that's all we see. We never see him. I don't know where he went. So that means I have to do it. It's just something we do. That's our thing. All right, family, let's get serious and give serious thanks, Ankhs, to Amma, the ancestors, for Dr. Clyde Winters. Let's give thanks for this union for Dr. Winters and Rev Shock to find each other, to be in synthesis with one another. Let's give Amma thanks that we are in our rightful mind to be here today, to see to be able to see the unseen, to make visible the invisible. We give thanks to Amma for our intelligentsia, understanding that we are the smartest people on earth because we were the first people on earth. And that we simply say, I am one with first frequency.
I am one with first frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the only one.
I am one with the only one.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
And so it is.